Magdalena Carmen Frida Kahlo Calderon was born in the Blue House in Coyoacan, Mexico on July 6, 1910, so she claimed. In 1981, two German television professionals who were working on a television special discovered that her official birth year was 1907. They interviewed Isabel Campos, a close friend of Frida's who attended primary school with Frida in Coyoacan. It was here that she advised that the year of 1910 was incorrect because Frida was only a year younger than she and Isabel was born in 1906. This led them to consult Frida's official birth certificate, which proved Isabel to be correct. So why the change? Passionate and unapologetic, Frida wanted to closely align herself with the ideas of liberation and reform that encompassed the Mexican Revolution. At least that is what is speculated. Hi everyone, I'm Jessica Gibson with Kaleidoscopes and Polka Dots, where I sell handmade vintage-inspired jewelry for the soul who's in love with the past, wholeheartedly lives in the present, and embraces the future. If you enjoy videos relating to vintage fashion, jewelry, and books, then please hit that subscribe button and that notification bell and sign up to my newsletter so that you never miss an episode. Details to my newsletter are linked down below. That is the best way to stay connected because when I'm not here, I will at least update you over there. Okay, so today I am sharing with you part one of my Frida Kahlo series. This series will encompass both a bit of history behind the great woman, and I will also share my journey into creating a Frida Kahlo inspired collection, which has proved to be quite a venture. I don't know if it's just that I am putting so much pressure on me because I love her, or if it's just that the universe is saying, take it easy, figure things out, and then come back to this. I don't know, maybe it's both, but you'll see. But to begin, let's talk about Frida and her life. Her father was Carl Wilhelm Kahlo. He was born on October 26, 1871 in Germany. With youthful enthusiasm, not knowing the language or anyone, he moved to Mexico in 1891 at the age of 19 with little more than the clothes he wore. Within a short time frame, while working as an accountant, he gained enough financial and social security to change his first name to Guillermo. By 1894, he married his first wife, a Mexican woman who died while giving birth to her second daughter. On the evening of her death, he met his second wife, Frida's mother, Matilde Calderon, a devout and pious Catholic. At her request, Guillermo Kahlo sent his two daughters from his first marriage to a convent, and he also switched occupations to that of a photographer. This was the same occupation that Matilde's father held. Guillermo flourished as a photographer, given that as an immigrant, he viewed his surroundings differently than most, and he was able to capture them with a fresh perspective. Guillermo Kahlo proved to have an eye for masterful composition of architecture and interior photographs, and quickly became one of the most sought-after photographers in modern Mexico. He used a large format camera, which he could only carry throughout the city and the county, aided by an assistant, which was usually Frida. He used this camera to capture carefully composed scenes in long exposure shots, resulting in great depth of field. In 1904, the government commissioned him to photograph all the key national monuments to mark the centenary of Mexican independence in 1910. Unfortunately for Guillermo Kahlo, in 1911, the dictatorial Mexican president, Porfirio Díaz, was forced to resign. He was the one who commissioned his work. This placed Guillermo and his family in great financial strain. In the last years of his life, Diego Rivera, his son-in-law, would provide him with financial assistance while he and his family continued to live in the Blue House. Of all of his daughters, he had a total of six. Two from his first marriage and four with Matilde, Frida's mother. He said that Frida was his favorite. Of her, he would say, "Frida is my most intelligent daughter. She is most like me. She was a lively, cheeky child and quite the go-getter." At 6 years old, Frida contracted polio, which led her to be bedridden for 9 months in excruciating pain. This was the first period in her life where she was forced into isolation for medical reasons. Polio is a disabling and life-threatening disease caused by the polio virus. It spreads from person to person and can infect a person's spinal cord, causing paralysis. In the case of Frida, it left her right leg deformed. Of this period of isolation, she recounts, "I must have been around 6 years old when I started vividly picturing to myself a friendship with another girl of about my own age. I used to blow on the window of my room, which gave onto Alanda Street, and draw a door on the pane. I imagine that I then ran full of excited anticipation out through this door and across the vast plain, which I saw in my mind's eye stretching out before me until I reached the Bison, Finch Diary. There I slept through the O in Bison and immediately plunged into the bowels of the earth, where the playmate of my dreams awaited me. I no longer remember her form and coloring, but I do know that she was a lot of fun and laughed a great deal. Soundlessly, of course. She was very nimble and could dance. When I returned to my window from my imaginary excursion, I came back through the door. Then I rubbed it out quickly with my fingers to make it disappear." So I'm going to stop her story here. I will come back to it in my next video. Hopefully it'll be in 2 weeks from now, because I have quite a lot of work to do, as you'll see. Next, I'm going to go over all of the designs that I have created in anticipation for this new collection. But first, before I get started though, I actually want to talk about my love for Frida, where it stems from, and how it's affecting my design process, because it's actually affecting it quite a lot. I was first introduced to Frida Kahlo via the movie Frida with Salma Hayek. I loved the movie when I first saw it. I loved the imagery. I recently watched it and now I remember why I loved it so much. It's very artistic and was actually directed by a woman whose name I can't think of right now, but it totally makes sense. It was beautifully done and it captured Frida's life in a really touching way. However, it also left me feeling really sad. At least that's what I remember. When I first watched it, I remember feeling really heartbroken afterwards, but not like in excruciating pain, but just enough to where I just didn't want to rewatch it. Coming back to it recently and watching it again, I understand why. It's the same reason why I love Frida's work. It's her relationship with Diego. It's not so much her relationship with Diego, it's love. I'm in love with love, and not so much being in love, but what love encompasses for each individual. It's what we do with that inspiration that we derive from love, from being in love, or from being heartbroken. Obviously, in Frida's case, her love for Diego inspired a lot of her work. And it is so heartbreaking, but so beautiful. As a young girl, I really didn't like it because it was so dark. Now I love it because it is so real. Love isn't sunshine and rainbows, although it can be, but it is incredibly painful, especially when things don't quite work out as you expect them to or want them to. And the way that she was able to capture her love for Diego and create something so evocative is why I am so in love with her work, as I'm sure many others are, but that is where I'm coming from when I'm creating these pieces. I really love Frida because she inspired me to see love through a different lens. Now, I'm not saying that her relationship with Diego was perfect, because it's certainly not, but she chose to marry him even though she knew that he could never be faithful to her. Who am I or anybody to say that that isn't the right way to go about a marriage? It obviously worked for her. I mean, because she said it did. And because Diego completed her, and that says a lot. I mean, not everybody can find their Diego, their inspiration, their holy grail. I want my collection to reflect my love for Frida, my love for her work, my love for art. My first idea with this collection was to create a rose and to make the rose into different pieces and to perfect this rose in a way that speaks to Frida, that is beautiful, passionate, and artistic, and that says this is something that Frida would wear. The more I learn about her, the more I realize that she didn't just have roses on her mind like I do when I think of her. She had the world in her fashion choices. But that is where I'm coming from. I want to create a rose that says this is Frida. By the way, I'm going to be very critical of all of my pieces here. By no means do I think these pieces are all garbage. I don't think any of them are garbage, actually. I just think that they are not fulfilling my need. So with this piece, I was playing around with shading, and therefore there are different kinds of beads and different patterns within it, this brooch. Ultimately, I decided that it would be better if I just stuck to one color scheme and didn't try to shade as much, because it ultimately detracts from the overarching design. That is one of the reasons this was a fail. Also, the fact that to me it doesn't look like a rose, and the rose is what I'm going for. This I took inspiration from the Blue House. It was inspired just simply because of the center bead. It's a Swarovski crystal coin bead, and I love it. I love this design. However, ooh, it's a lot. It's a lot, and I envisioned it being a necklace, such as that she's wearing it in this picture, but it needs to be toned down. Also, I think that Frida is known for very earthy tones, and there's just a lot of glitz that's going on in this design. I designed a secondary piece, very similar to that one, but with more earthy tones, and I think this one was much more successful. I love that it's subtle, and I think it works a lot better as a brooch. Now, notably, both of these designs have tassels on them. Actually, all of them so far have tassels on them. I'm in love with tassels, and from what I can see, Frida loves tassels herself. But I took a step back, and I thought, you know what? The design itself, the center design, is enough, and I think it would be enough for most people, and I think it conveys the message perfectly. This one to me is a good solid design, and actually something that I think will make it to the final collection. And I'm so excited to style it and show it off in the near future. By the way, I kind of took a step back from everything while I was designing all of these, something that I didn't intend to do on purpose. It just kind of happens, and it usually always happens when I'm in the middle of designing something, and I don't like that about myself. I don't like that I can't do so many things at once. For this next round of edits and of designs, I am planning on sharing a lot more on Instagram as I work them. This series is probably going to be a bi-weekly series, because I really want to dedicate time to researching her life as well as designing, and all of that takes a lot of time. So in the interim, I'm going to be sharing a lot more on Instagram and having polls. So if you're interested in sharing your feedback with me, which I would absolutely love and appreciate, I would highly recommend that you follow me over on Instagram so that you take part in the polls and share with me your thoughts, because I value your opinion. After I did those three designs, I came back to the rose and I made this necklace, which is stunning. It just doesn't look like enough of a rose. It is beautiful as it is, but it looks just like a red flower. I'm still stuck on creating the perfect Frida rose. So I may have to give up on that, to be honest, at some point, but I am still, at this point in time, determined to find the perfect Frida rose. So after I did that, I ventured into two more roses. In the future, there will not be this many designs. I promise myself that, because, oh my gosh, these took so much time. I love this one. Both of these are brooches, because it has the little leaves on the side. And I added the leaves because after I finished the centerpiece, I thought, it doesn't look like anything. And my husband actually just mentioned that it looks like some kind of fruit. I think it's because of the center. Then I made this other one, which has a little bit more texture to it. This one looks most like a rose, but it's still not the perfect Frida rose. After that, I got a little frustrated, and I consulted my books and found that I had created these flowers in the past, and I love these flowers. They are so delicate and cute, and I think they could totally work for like flower accessories, for hair accessories, and actually I think that's what I'm going to end up doing with these. So I think I might be venturing into the hair accessory world for this next collection. I am so excited. These could be part of pins or like a headband. There's so many possibilities. That is the beauty of beads. I love beading. It is so exciting to see how everything comes together and talks to each other. you know, I don't know, the colors, the beads, the shapes, everything. That is it for my video today. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please give me a big thumbs up. Again, subscribe to my channel, subscribe to my newsletter, and let me know what you think. By the way, I don't think I mentioned it earlier, but you get a 20% off discount code, which you can use on anything, new or old. So there's that. And I will also be having a giveaway for quite a few of these pieces because honestly, I can't wear them all. There's too many of them. So I will be sharing those details in my newsletter at some point. Let me know which of these pieces is your favorite. How would you style them? And let me know, what would you absolutely love to see in a Frida-inspired collection? What do you think is missing? What colors would you love to embrace? I mean, to me, red and hot pink are it, but I would love to know your opinions. All right, I will talk to you again soon. Bye. Like many people, I love love, and that was actually one of the first things that I told my husband when we were first getting to know each other.